And so I have titled my sermon today on the shepherd and his flock, to reflect on who really our shepherd is, and indeed if we are part of that flock. As we shall soon see from the scriptures, there are many shepherds who will come to the sheep pen and ask us to follow them. But Jesus is saying that he comes through the front door and his sheep know his voice. Because there are many shepherds that are out there and they all desire that we follow them. And they present themselves in our lives and they want to take a portion. And sometimes because of the needs that we have in the world, we are easily carried away. I pray that we will be able to recognize the true shepherd and know his voice and follow him only and not other shepherds. Whom shall we follow?
In the book of John, chapter 10, verse 1 to 18, I will read the scripture from the Message translation because I found it beautiful. And the Bible says, let me set this before you as plainly as I can, verse 1.
If a person climbs over or through the fence of a sheep pen instead of going through the gate, you know he is up to no good. He is a sheep rustler. The shepherd walks right up to the gate. The gatekeeper opens the gate to him. And the sheep recognize his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he gets them all out, he leads them and they follow because they are familiar with his voice. They won't follow a stranger's voice, but will scatter because they aren't used to the sound of it. Jesus told this simple story, but they had no idea what he was talking about. And so he said, let me try again. I will be explicit then. I am the gate for the sheep. All those others are up to no good. They are sheep stealers, every one of them. But the sheep didn't listen to them. I am the gate. Anyone who goes through me will be cared for, will freely go in and out and find pasture. A thief is only there to steal and kill and destroy. I came so that they can have real and eternal life, more and better life than they ever dreamt of. Verse 11, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd puts the sheep before himself, sacrifices himself if necessary. A hired man is not a real shepherd. The sheep mean nothing to him. He sees a wolf come and runs for it, leaving the sheep to be ravaged and scattered by the wolf. He is only in it for the money. The sheep don't matter to him. But I am the good shepherd. I know my own sheep and my own sheep know me. In the same way the Father knows me, I know the Father. I put the sheep before myself, sacrificing myself. You need to know that I have other sheep in addition to those in this pen. I need to gather and bring them too. They will also recognize my voice. Then it will be one flock, one shepherd. This is why the Father loves me. Because I freely lay down my life, and so I am free to take it up again. No one takes it from me. I lay it down of my own free will. I have the right to lay it down. I also have the right to take it up again. I received this authority personally from my Father. Praise God. May the Lord bless his word. How I pray that all of us believers would have a slogan and say, one flock, one shepherd. But unfortunately, we are living in a time where many shepherds appear to us every day. We are confused and we give consideration to follow others because there are needs in the world and we want to become. And sometimes we are presented with shortcuts. We are presented with ways that we can follow and find the comfort that we are ever looking for. But Jesus is saying, all these shepherds are not coming through the gate. He is saying they are jumping over the fence. He is saying they are coming through the holes in the fence. He is saying you are not secure in their hands. He is saying because you know me, you will not follow their voice because you know my voice. And therefore we will reject and say no to any other voice except the voice of the true one who laid his life and sacrificed himself for our sake. We shall be his followers. In my youth, we had a little song that we used to say, I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. How can we become like him? How can we become like the Savior? Becoming like the Savior is gradual. It is a lifelong process, and you can begin by taking small steps every day. And I'm saying this knowing that perhaps in our midst, there are people who have never begun this journey. And I am going to give you an opportunity to choose to begin to follow Jesus. I'm saying this because I know that there are some who have got distracted on the way. And we have found other things that have become attractive along the way. And Jesus is saying, come back and follow the true shepherd. Whoever else is whistling on the side is not my voice. He's saying, come and follow me. We are encouraged through the scriptures to become like Jesus Christ. In 1 John 2:6, it says, to walk even as he walked. But taking that first step can be difficult, especially when you don't know how to begin. And sometimes it is confusing. We are in a world where we are confused. We don't know, do I begin? Sometimes the enemy comes to us and instills fear. And I have found that fear is one of the greatest impediments. I have heard people tell me, Pastor, I don't want to get saved. I don't want to continue with this journey because I tried and I could not make it. Friend, it is not about you. It is about hearing the voice of the one that you are following. Who is ahead of you? Praise the Lord. Who are you following? And to give you three things that you must. Three things that you must get from the character of our Lord. It is among the many things that you can be able to pick. But I will give you three things that I feel this morning the Lord is calling us. If we want to be like him and to follow him, we must give ourselves up to. And Jesus himself, when he lived on this earth, he was a submissive person. So we are going to look at the number one thing, a submission, which is a very difficult thing in a world today. And because Jesus was submissive, we are called to be submissive for the Lord's sake, not for our own sake. This is instituted to every authority among men. And let me tell you, if you cannot be able to be submissive to the authority that God has given to you while you're living here on earth, then it is even more difficult to submit to his authority. Although we claim to follow in the footsteps of Jesus, we struggle with submission. Because the world has taught us to rebel. Because the world has taught us to have our own way. Because the world has told us that there is not only one way. There are authorities that have been placed in our lives. Right from our homes, the Lord has set up a government headed by a man being the head. And he has commanded the man to love his wife. But the man today is saying, how can I love her? And she has not done what is expected of her as a wife. Culture demands that she treats me this way, and she doesn't. And therefore, how can you tell me to obey, to be submissive to her by loving her? Submission is interpreted to mean slavery, but it is not. It means humility. It means obeying. It means doing what God has asked you to do. And so it is true, man. We are called to be submissive to our wives by loving them the way they are. If I was a lady, I would say a big amen and clap for the Lord. And so to the wife, you are called to be submissive to him. Yes. God is calling you to be submissive to him, not because of what he puts on the table, because the bread that you find on the table comes from the Lord. Somebody praise the Lord. God is not asking you to be submissive to him because he has a good job, or because he has a big name, or because he is standing for election and likely you are going to be Mrs. Muheshimiwa. That is not why God is asking you to be submissive to him. I wonder if I became a governor, whether my wife would treat me differently when she starts to be called the first lady. And I want her to know she is a first lady even right now. Praise God. Because God has called us to that submission to authority that he has given to us today. And for the children to honor their parents. And let me tell you, if they see us treating each other the godly way, even our children will live to honor God and they will inherit longer life. And perhaps we are denying our children long life because they cannot honor us because we are not honorable before God. You deserve that title of honorable so-and-so. You deserve it. It is God's will that we do good and silence the ignorant talk of foolish men. The world is filled with rebellious teaching against the authority that God has set. Yet God has called us to live as free men without using the freedom to cover up for evil. We ought to live as servants of God, showing respect to everyone. The book of 1 Peter 2 and verse 17 says, show proper respect to everyone. Love the brotherhood of believers, fear God, and honor the king. Yes, that which God has put in authority. And when you do this, you are not doing anything peculiar. You are doing what God has called you to do. He says in 1 Peter 2, 21, and he says, to this you are called because Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his footsteps. Do you obey or submit to those that can reciprocate? When they hurled insults to Jesus, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. Yes, Jesus is our great example. And he is saying, don't only submit because they reciprocate or because they are good to you. You don't submit to them because of what you get back. But you submit because Jesus has taught us to be humble. Jesus, as our great example, greed never touched him. Power never corrupted him. Worldliness never reached him. Incompetence never tripped him. Personal ambition never swayed him. Selfishness never chained him. He is worthy as our great example. He is our leader. He is someone who is worthy following. Let's follow our Lord Jesus. I wish I could hear some more amens. Because sincerely, if we don't follow Jesus, we will find ourselves following the wrong examples, and we are in trouble. The second thing I want us to look from the character of Jesus is compassion. And Jesus was always moved by compassion. In Matthew 9, verse 35 to 38, we see Jesus being moved by compassion and seeing multitudes without a shepherd. He was moved with compassion upon them. And therefore, when the Lord sees you and sees your desperate situation, when the Lord sees your sinful nature, when God himself sees how far you have walked away from him, he is filled with compassion, and his son, the Lord Jesus Christ, is gracious unto you. That is why he gave his life for your own sake. Will you clothe yourself with compassion? In Matthew 20, verse 29 and 34, in compassion, he healed the two blind men on the road beyond Jericho. In Luke 7, 11 to 17, in compassion, he raised the son of the widow of Nain when he saw the tears and the pain that was in her heart. In John 19, verse 25 to 27, he is asking his disciple John to take care of his mother, even when he was at the cross, bearing the pain of being put on the cross, he was compassionate towards his mother. And so he is compassionate to you and me today. How many are in your neighborhood? How many are in your place of work? How many do you interact with as your customers? How many are there that you could extend your compassion to? How many? Will Jesus ever come to you on the judgment day and he will say, I was without clothes and you never clothed me? Or he will say, you found me naked and you gave me a blanket? Friends, if we are following in the footsteps of Jesus, our hearts are moved with compassion upon those who would be blessed by our generosity. Or by our prayers, or by our remembrance, or by our encouragement. To be someone sensitive to the heart and the need of someone else. And that's to be like our Lord and to follow in his footsteps. It means that you will look around always for opportunities of those who you can walk with, of those who you can hold their hands and walk with them and tell them, because of what the Lord has done for me, receive from me. The third character of our Lord Jesus Christ is that he is socialized. Socializing is not as easy as you think it is. Yes, we love to socialize, but we socialize with friends and we socialize with those that are our peers. We socialize with those who have invited us and we can be able to go there and we can identify with them. We love to socialize with those who can reciprocate. But look at our Lord Jesus Christ in Matthew chapter 11 and verse 18 to 19. He contrasts himself between John the Baptist, who was a serious guy. He was a loner who lived apart and separate from the multitudes. But Jesus was ever in the heart and in the midst of the moving masses of people. Jesus never turned away an invitation to dinner. How many of you are willing to invite me for dinner tonight? I will be like Jesus. I will not turn it down. Hallelujah. But this is not the kind of socializing that Jesus is looking for. He is not looking for you to go and socialize with those that are your friends and are your congregants and are the people that you hang around with. Listen to Jesus. Whenever he was invited for dinner, He never looked at who is this who is inviting me for dinner. Yes, he never turned an invitation down. If you wanted the Lord Jesus to come and eat with you, all you had to do was invite him and he would be there, no matter who you are and where it was. In Luke chapter 7, verse 36 to 50, we see Jesus Christ going to eat dinner in the house of a Pharisee named Simon. And this is the opportunity that Jesus had to meet the woman with the alabaster jar who had lived in sin all her life. It is here that she was able to wet his feet with her tears. It is here that she got an opportunity to wipe his feet with her hair. It is here that she had the opportunity to pour expensive perfume on his feet and use her hair to wipe them. And as a result, her sins were forgiven. If Jesus didn't go for dinner to these Pharisees, he would not have met this woman. How many opportunities do we miss to change people's lives because we choose who to socialize with? In Luke chapter 11, verse 37 to 54, he went to eat dinner with some Pharisees, and knowing that they were not for him, but they had invited him so that they could see if they can find fault on him. But Jesus knew this. But instead, he went there and he taught them the truth and he rebuked them of their pride. He looked at it as an opportunity and he said, yes, they may not be calling me for the right reasons, but this is my opportunity. And this is when he taught this great teaching and he told them that they wash their cup on the outside, whereas in the inside they were filled with greed and wickedness. This did not deter Jesus from dining with him. And we can go on and search the scriptures and we will find many places that Jesus went. For example, in Luke chapter 14, verse 1 to 24, again Jesus is eating at the house of yet another prominent Pharisee on a Sabbath. And there was a man who was suffering from a disease. And Jesus knew it is a Sabbath. And he knew if I healed this man, I would be criticized. But he said, this is the right thing to do. And he took the opportunity to teach these people a new gospel. In verse 12, he taught his host to care for the less fortunate. And he told him, when you give a luncheon or dinner, do not invite your friends. Do not invite your brothers or relatives or your rich neighbors. If you do, they may invite you back and so you will be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed. Although they cannot repay you, you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous. Hallelujah. There is never an instance when Jesus was invited to eat dinner with anyone that he didn't accept the invitation. Because he saw it as an opportunity. How many opportunities do we miss? Look at Jesus in John chapter 4. And here, this entire chapter is dedicated to Jesus socializing with a despised outcast Samaritan woman who had 5 husbands. And even the man that she was living with, she didn't even bother to marry him. Yet, Jesus socialized with her. And as a result, an entire town came to be delivered because of knowing the Lord Jesus, because he socialized with an outcast Samaritan woman. And finally, in Mark 1 and verse 40 to 45, we are told the story of Jesus and the leper. And during those times, the lepers were outcasts, and they were required by law to cover their faces. And they would walk, and they would not even want to be seen, and they would be walking with their hand on their eyes, and they would go shouting, "Unclean, unclean, I am unclean, I am unclean." And when you heard those words, you did not need to be told to walk away. You just went out of this man's way because he is unclean, and you did not want to touch an unclean person. But as he walked with his uncleanness, and he knew Jesus was in the midst of the crowd, this man walked calling unclean, and everybody gave their way. And this man just goes and finds Jesus where he was. And guess what? Jesus did not move away like everybody else moved away. But instead, he took out his hand and he stretched on the man and he touched him. And the warmth of his hand healed this person because no one else was willing to touch him. How many lepers come your way? How many people are looking for your warm hand to make a change? Because everybody else has despised them. Somebody praise the Lord. I said, somebody praise the Lord. And says, my warm hand will touch somebody and change their life. I'm not going to walk away, but I'm going to stand in their way. And when they walk over to me, I'm going to touch them and change them. I believe that the cure was the touch of that loving and compassionate hand upon whom Jesus Christ touched, despite he was an outcast. And so as we come to an end, if you're going to follow the footsteps of Jesus, then the street people, the filthy people, the dirty and the homeless and the outcasts, they need our kind gesture. Will you pay a little attention? Because in the name of Jesus, he touches and changes. And so you can use that name and touch and change because you're following in his footsteps.